Thank you. The next item of business is a debate on motion 14614 in the name of Shona Robinson on the UK budget, Scotland's priorities. I would invite those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons. And hello, excuse me. I'm actually speaking, so I'd appreciate people perhaps listening to what I had to say. And I call on the Cabinet Secretary, Shona Robinson, to speak to and to move the motion. Up to 13 minutes, please.
Thank you. Presiding Officer, 3 weeks ago I set out the challenges facing the Scottish Budget and the difficult decisions that this Government was taking to balance the Budget and deliver on our priorities. I told Parliament that the new UK Government had made clear funding would continue to be constrained, and the Prime Minister has said that this year's UK Budget would be painful. For as long as our budget is tied to decisions taken in Westminster, then we will not be immune from this pain. Just as we were unable to avoid all the damage caused by the years of Tory austerity, the chaos of the Truss mini budget, and of course Brexit, which has reduced the size of the UK economy by 2.5%, equating to a £2.3 billion annual cut in revenue in Scotland. The UK budget on the 30th of October is an opportunity to take a different approach. I want to work with the Chancellor and the governments in Wales and Northern Ireland to ensure that the UK budget delivers for all four nations. Since the new Labour UK government took office, we have committed to work constructively, and I've written to the Chancellor setting out our priorities and offering to work together to achieve these. And I'm pleased to have seen a distinct improvement in the relationship with the Treasury since the election, and it's important that this continues. I'll be meeting the Chief Secretary to the Treasury along with the Welsh and Northern Irish Finance Ministers next month to discuss Scotland's priorities for the UK budget, and I look forward to hearing from members across the Chamber on this issue. The Chancellor set out in her July statement the pressures on the UK public finances, but she is constrained in dealing with that by her own fiscal rules. These limit the Chancellor's room to achieve her own ambitions and, with it, damage our plans for Scotland. But we must be clear, this is a political choice to follow the Tories' fiscal rules, and there is another way. We propose the rule governing net debt should be replaced with a focus on public sector net worth, which would allow for further borrowing for investment to renew public infrastructure and services. It would allow the Chancellor to move away from an approach that risks embedding austerity further, and this would help provide the investment that we need and which could boost jobs and ease some of the fiscal pressures that we're facing. The Chancellor's own spending audit estimated this year's departmental spending budgets are at least £15 billion lower in real terms compared to 2021 spending review plans. This means that public services have been consistently shortchanged over the past few years, so it's no wonder that the governments of all four nations are now facing such acute pressures. It's vital that the Chancellor uses her upcoming budget to reset spending plans, to take account of the inflation of recent years and to make clear the UK government plans for investing in public services. These investment plans should include full funding of pay awards on a recurring basis. If not, this will leave a substantial gap between the expectations of the workforce and available funding. Yesterday, I noted the Royal College of Nursing in Scotland accepted the NHS agenda for pay deal in Scotland, but rejected the deal offered in England by the UK government. My suggestion to the UK government would be to ensure that before the budget, they offer to match NHS Agenda for Change pay here in Scotland. That would see an experienced nurse in England get an uplift of over £3,200 more than the deal they rejected. And of course it means that in 2024-25 an experienced Band 5 nurse here will take home £2,233 more after income tax and national insurance compared to the same band in England. Our public services are knitted into the very fabric of our country and our daily lives. More funding for our schools, hospitals and local government services helps grow our economy, enhance quality of life and, of course, tackle the scourge of poverty. The First Minister has been clear that ending child poverty is a central priority of this government. For many years, we've had to step in to protect the most vulnerable in our society as best we can from the actions of a UK government that has pushed households into hardship through austerity. We are spending £134 million this year alone to mitigate damaging welfare policies put in place by the previous UK government, including the benefit cap and the bedroom tax. This is money that could have been spent on services like health and education or on further ambitious anti-poverty measures. We're also investing £457 million this year through our Scottish Child Payment, helping the families of over 325,000 under-16s who currently receive it. However, the impacts of this game-changing payment are being counteracted by policies like the two-child limit. With our limited fixed budget, we cannot mitigate all of the UK government's policies whilst pursuing our own ambitious policy agenda. And that's why this new Labour UK government must act now to reverse the Tories' welfare decisions and take a different approach, including steps towards delivery of an essentials guarantee. Abolishing the two-child limit should be an easy choice, and I know members will join me in urging the Chancellor to consign this dreadful policy to the dustbin. The Institute for Fiscal Studies has calculated that abolishing the two-child limit could immediately lift 360,000 children out of poverty across the UK, rising to 500,000 by the time the policy is rolled out in full. This is also an opportunity for the Labour UK government to think again about its decision to restrict the winter fuel payment. This decision has been roundly criticised, and of course it's not too late to reverse it. I read reporting online in The Guardian yesterday that suggested, quote, Scottish Labour believes access to the winter fuel allowance could be widened in Scotland as it tries to fight off its opponents' attacks before the next Holyrood election. It seems that not content with this Parliament mitigating Labour's two-child limit, they now expect us to mitigate Labour's cut to pensioners' winter fuel payments. The question is, would it not be simpler all round if Labour simply didn't cut this funding to the elderly in the first place? Investing in our vital infrastructure is key to growing our economy and achieving net zero. Yet we are dealing with the legacy of years of underinvestment by previous UK governments and the continuing impact of high inflation. Capital investment needs to grow substantially to renew public infrastructure and deliver on net zero projects. But we're facing an expected real terms reduction to our UK capital funding of 8.7% over 5 years. That equates to a cumulative loss of £1.3 billion between 2023-24 and 2027-28. Now, we have successfully used financial transactions funding to deliver affordable housing, fund our Scottish National Investment Bank and invest through our enterprise agencies. However, that funding from the UK government has fallen by 62% since 2022-23, and we need to see it replaced if we are to continue to support our businesses and build more of the housing that we so urgently need. We must also build for the future, investing now to harness the opportunities of a just transition to net zero. We're already ahead of the rest of the UK in renewables, but we need to go further. And I'm pleased that good progress has been made on a memorandum of understanding with the UK government on GB Energy, which needs to deliver real benefits for the people of Scotland and support a just transition to net zero by 2045. And I'm pleased to hear that GB Energy will be located in Aberdeen. I think that's absolutely the right decision. I look forward to further discussions with the UK Government on plans for GB Energy, and I'm keen to ensure that the Crown Estate Scotland receives equivalent and proportionate benefits to those being granted to the Crown Estate. We also want to see the UK Government's new National Wealth Fund working with the Scottish public bodies and the Scottish National Investment Bank to unlock investment and make our net zero ambitions a reality. Most of the tax levers that can help address the pressures that we face remain with the UK Government. In Scotland, we have used our tax levers to raise revenue to support investment in our public services. Our progressive decisions on income tax since the devolution of powers will raise up to an estimated £1.5 billion of additional revenue in 2024-25 compared to if we had matched UK Government policy. Yet, income tax revenues alone are not sufficient to deliver fiscal sustainability over the medium term. The UK Government currently holds wider levers on tax and funding and must consider how these are used to allow necessary investment in public services. Yes.
Murdo Fraser.
I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. On the issue of tax, given everything she's said about the use of tax levers, does she now regret the decision taken by the Cabinet to freeze council tax for the current year?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the decision to freeze council tax, of course, was a support given the pressure on household incomes due to the cost of living crisis driven by the decisions of Murdo Fraser's UK Tory government. And, of course, the mini-budget, the catastrophic mini-budget that sent inflation high sky. And I think Murdo Fraser was indeed a supporter of Liz Truss and wanted us to follow the tax decisions that Liz Truss has made. So I'm not sure Murdo Fraser is in the best position to give me any advice on income tax or any other tax at all in this place. I will be presenting the Scottish Budget on the 4th of December, and I've already told Parliament that this will be a challenging budget. However, despite it being only 71 days away from our budget, I simply don't know yet how much funding we'll have for next year, and I'm looking to the Chancellor to give some further clarity on the 30th of October. Our call has been to move away from an approach focused on annual funding. We need greater certainty of funding to help the devolved governments plan further ahead. So I welcome the Chancellor's intention to move to multi-year budgets, and I want to work with her to ensure they provide the certainty we need for our own medium-term budget planning. Now, the new UK Government has said...
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
I appreciate what the Cabinet Secretary is saying about the lack of certainty from the UK Government in terms of the financial settlement. But what we do have clarity on is the reserves that the Scottish Government is sitting on, not least the revenues that were forthcoming as a result of the ScotWind leasing round. Can she confirm to the Scottish Parliament how much of that money is left for next year's budget?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I've confirmed that in a written answer, I think, to Alec Cole-Hamilton, which has shown that we only utilised about 96 million of ScotWind revenues for 23-24. But the point about the £460 million that I have said would have to be set against path to balance, the thing that will change that and will reduce that, which I am very keen to do, is if the pay awards, the UK pay review body awards, are funded in full. So the more they are funded, the less ScotWind I will need to use. There is an absolute direct correlation there. So we wait to hear what the Chancellor has to say. I want to make one final point, Presiding Officer, if that is okay. The new UK Government has said it will respect devolution. Now, we saw in June that it was splashed on the front page of the Daily Record that a £150 million war chest would be handed to the Scotland Office to spend in devolved areas, along with lines from the new Scottish Secretary Ian Murray. What's stranger still is at the weekend, Ian Murray gave an interview where he said that a journalist had made up the £150 million figure. Then yesterday, he gave further clarification that despite his slur that the journalist had not made it up, and instead, what he meant was he didn't have the money yet. So, at this stage, my best guess to explain Ian Murray's behaviour is that he doesn't think he's actually getting £150 million from the Treasury. Or perhaps Ian Murray is demanding there should be no more bypassing of this Parliament through the UK Government spending money in devolved areas, something we would welcome. And it's really important that the Labour's clear manifesto commitment to end the practice of bypassing devolved nations is delivered and delivered in full. Presiding Officer, I want to work with the Chancellor to make sure that the UK budget delivers for Scotland. It does not need to be another budget of austerity and underinvestment. Instead, it can be a budget that renews public infrastructure, helps tackle child poverty and supports keeping and attracting jobs with fiscal rules that values public services. These are the choices I encourage the Chancellor to make. I urge all members to support the motion today and I move the motion in my name.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I now call on Murdo Fraser to speak to and move Amendment 14614.2. Up to 9 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Well, it is a novel experience for those of us on this side of the chamber that, for the first time in 14 years, we are not in government in Westminster and therefore not having to defend a budget which is on its way, which will bring an interesting new slant to my remarks, Presiding Officer. And to borrow a line we've heard from the other side of the chamber several times, I can say with all integrity that Scotland is being failed by both of its governments, the one in Holyrood and the one in Westminster, because we've had a dismal start already from the new Labour government, and not surprising to see the ratings of the Prime Minister already in freefall. Let's look, if we can, first of all, at the Labour Party in government and what is going to come from its budget before I turn to the Scottish National Party. The economic legacy inherited by the Labour government is far better than they would suggest, despite the headwinds all Western governments have faced ever since the financial crash of 2008-2009, a financial crash, of course, under the watch of a Labour Chancellor and a Labour government at that time. Despite that, the UK economy has performed well in relation to many competitor economies. UK GDP grew faster than any other European country in the G7 in that period, and faster than the EU as a whole in that same period. And we avoided the depth of recession, for example, seen in Germany. In that same period, we saw 4 million new jobs created and record levels of employment, and inflation returning very close to the Bank of England target of 2%. So the economic legacy inherited by the Labour government was a strong one in relative terms, as indeed was the financial legacy. According to the Office of Budget Responsibility, the deficit Labour inherited is 4.5%. Now, Mr Johnson's shaking his head at that. Let me remind him that the financial deficit Labour left when they left office in 2010 was 10.3%. Whoa. Nearly more than double what the Conservatives left Labour when they came in. But if the Deputy First Minister wants to intervene to defend the Labour government, I'll give way to her instead.
Deputy First Minister. If the member could confirm the deficit of the Scottish Government, which by law is required to balance its budget every year.
Martin Fraser.
I think the Deputy First Minister will be very familiar with her own GERS figures that set out the nominal deficit of the Scottish Government. Where would you become an independent country? Double the rate of the UK as a whole. Of course I'll give another.
Deputy
another
First Minister.
I didn't think the member needed a lesson in the difference between the Scottish Government's budget and projected figures, but can he confirm whether the Scottish Government has balanced its budget every year for the last 17 years?
Murdo Fraser.
Well, what the Deputy First Minister is tempting me to do, Presiding Officer, is congratulate the Scottish Government for not breaking the law. Not breaking the law. Because the law says you have to balance their budget. If that is the height of ambition of the Deputy First Minister, that we should congratulate this government for not breaking the law, I think they have to do better than that, Presiding Officer. So we have a deficit, as we know, that was far greater when Labour left office at the last time. Now, Labour talk about this £22 billion, the fabled £22 billion black hole, and yet we know from all the independent analysis that's done, £9.4 billion of that total came not from the previous Conservative government, from the above-inflation pay deals agreed by Labour since they came to power. And, of course, it's no wonder Labour are confused about their sums, as the Cabinet Secretary reminded us, the new Scottish Secretary is in total confusion over the amount of money available to him. The fabled £150 million, supposedly, that his Scotland office was going to get. He accused journalists of making up that figure, and then it turns out he misspoke. That was indeed his figure, but not surprising. This is the man, after all, whose first major intervention in his new office was to diss Larry the cat, the nation's favourite feline, the favourite pussycat of the nation. And what does Ian Murray describe it as, Deputy Presiding Officer, I could not use that language in a parliamentary session. This is the mark of the man. You would never have got Alistair Jack saying these things about Larry the Cat. This is what Ian Murray is saying, Presiding Officer. And yet, what do we see now from Labour? This shameful attack on pensioners with the removal of the winter fuel allowance. Nearly 900,000 pensioners in Scotland affected by that. No wonder their ratings are plummeting, Presiding Officer. Although, of course, it is correct to say the SNP could do something about that if indeed they wanted. So now we look at the choices in the Labour budget. Now, the Labour Party have said they won't increase VAT, they won't increase income tax, they won't increase national insurance. What in taxes are we going to see increased? Are we going to see fuel duty increased, hitting those who have to rely upon their cars to travel around? Are we going to see capital gains tax increased, Presiding Officer? When Jeremy Hunt reduced the rate, the top rate of capital gains tax from 26% to 24%, in the spring budget. At that point, the estimates were that would actually increase revenue because it would stimulate activity. An increase in the capital gains tax will hit entrepreneurs, hit those who are wanting to invest in businesses and sell them on. Is that going to help stimulate economic growth? Or will it be inheritance tax that is increased, hitting those who have built up savings over their lives and wanting to pass them on to their families? Or will it be the energy profits levy being extended still further? The energy profits levy risking, according to energy experts, over 200,000 jobs, a reckless attack on the oil and gas sector that is so important to the economy of Scotland and the North East in particular. Of course.
Daniel Johnson.
Described the energy profits levy as a reckless attack. Would he remind the Chamber which party of government introduced that reckless attack? Which party introduced the energy profits levy?
Martin Fraser.
Sir, we are not proposing to take away the allowances in the way that the Labour Party are currently doing. We're not proposing to turn off the tap on North Sea oil and gas that the Labour Party is threatening to do. If you ask businesses in Aberdeen and the North East, Presiding Officer, which party they think can be trusted on oil and gas, it's certainly not the Labour Party, as we'll hear more from my colleague Douglas Lumsden shortly. But let's look, having spoken about the Labour Party for too long, let's look at some of the choices the SNP have to make, because the budget challenges facing the SNP at the moment are a result of their own choices. That's not my analysis, it's analysis of the Institute for Fiscal Studies. It's the analysis of the Scottish Fiscal Commission, who've said it's the Scottish Government's own decisions which are to blame for much of the pressure facing the country's finances. Yes, I have time.
Briefly, Cabinet Secretary Shirley-Ann Somerville.
Thank you. I'm grateful to the member for taking the intervention. I wonder how he might react then to the Sage 2 amendments in the Social Security Bill from his Conservative colleagues, which were adding to the Social Security. You cannot come to the Chamber, Presiding Officer, as an opposition spokesperson, demanding that we cut that funding and at the same time in a committee actually increase that funding at the same time.
Martin Fraser.
What the Cabinet Secretary should be doing is listening to the Scottish Fiscal Commission, what they said about the need for growth. Growth would deliver. If we only matched UK economic growth in the current year, it would deliver £624 million extra in tax revenues in the current year. The way we get more money to spend is to deliver growth, and that's a lesson this government needs to learn. And of course, what they never tell us, Presiding Officer, is the Barnett formula gives us, according to their own figures, the GERS figures, the Barnett formula gives us £2,400 per head of population more to spend in Scotland than the UK average. That's a result of us being in the United Kingdom. The very United Kingdom they want to take us out of, and we benefit by that additional sum that they have to spend as they choose. Of course, we know the choices the SNP have made. We know about the fact they've increased income taxes in Scotland. According to the recent survey by the Fraser of Allender Institute, more than one in three businesses are reporting that this has had a fair amount to a lot of impact on their ability to recruit. And we hear this all the time from businesses across Scotland, businesses in construction, in manufacturing, in hospitality, in financial services. The tax gap between Scotland and the rest of the UK is now actively deterring their ability to... Well, I've taken lots of interventions...
The member is bringing his remarks to a close.
Is now actively deterring them from attracting talent to come and work in Scotland. I know the Deputy First Minister gets that. I'm not sure the Finance Secretary does, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, I think I'm probably running out of time. So let me just say in closing here, Presiding Officer, what both governments should be doing. Both governments should be going for growth, lowering taxes, not raising taxes, passing on the rates relief that has been given by the UK government onto retail, hospitality and leisure businesses, supporting North Sea oil and gas and not seeking to close it down as Labour are trying to do, bringing in a national workforce plan for skills and investing in infrastructure in roads like the A9, A96, A75, A77 and the A1. Presiding Officer, we need to have a positive vision for Scotland. Instead, it's going backwards under the SNP and under Labour. The UK is heading in the same direction. We are being failed by two governments and we need to do better. I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you, Mr Fraser. I now call on Daniel Johnson to speak to and move amendment 14614.3 up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I move the amendment in my name? I have to say it's somewhat ironic, Murdo Fraser standing up and describing things being in freefall, because I remember almost exactly this time 2 years ago, and the thing that was in freefall was UK gilts and mortgage products being removed from the market as a direct consequence of the reckless decision made by his government, the last Tory government. So this is a bit of a strange... I don't know what the First Minister is saying from his sedentary permission, but perhaps we could have a bit more of a constructive debate, because it is a little bit strange having a debate about a budget 5 weeks before it's published. And if I can gently point out, you know, since the general election, the Scottish Government, indeed the First Minister, has met with the new Prime Minister, the new Deputy Prime Minister, the new Chancellor of the Exchequer. That might have been the appropriate time, if the budget was so important, to raise it. Look, the serious point is this. We have heard much, and can I acknowledge the point made by the Finance Secretary about the need for constructive dialogue? If I could just take a moment to finish the point. But there is a danger of a mixed message that today's debate is something of a hasty attempt to cry betrayal before we even had the budget, rather than actually seeking the cross-party cooperation that we seem to be being promised and seems to be on offer. If the Cabinet Secretary would like to give way, I'd be very happy
to. I think it was Siobhan Brown who was seeking to intervene.
If Siobhan Brown would like... apologies.
Siobhan Brown.
Thank you for taking the intervention. Given the importance of the UK budget and the consequentials to the Scottish Government to deliver for the people of Scotland that we all represent. Firstly, I think it's really disappointing there's only three Labour MSPs in attendance today in this debate. Yeah. But, Presiding Officer, I note the Labour amendment that you've put forward removes the mention of urging the UK Government to reverse the cuts to winter fuel payment and also remove the two-child limit on benefits. Does Mr Johnson not agree that the UK Government should be doing this to protect the people of Scotland that we all represent?
Daniel Johnson.
Well, that was a very well-read intervention. But look, there are serious issues at hand, and if she wants to where my Labour colleagues are, listening to the Prime Minister, listening to the plans that we have set out. Now, if this was such an important debate, maybe the Finance Committee would be here rather than in Estonia, because we all know fine well this was a very last-minute tabled debate. So let's not pretend that this is some serious attempt for discussion. It was a last-minute intervention. Let's not pretend it was anything other than a political stunt. If I could just... I'm happy to.
Cabinet Secretary?
The reason that it's important at this point is that next week I am going to meet with all the other finance ministers and the Chief Secretary to the Treasury, and I actually think it's important that I can relay what this Parliament thinks about the priorities for the Chancellor's upcoming budget at the end of October. I'm very surprised Daniel Johnson doesn't agree.
Daniel Johnson.
So important that it was only tabled at the end of last week. But look, if we want to talk about budgets, maybe the Cabinet Secretary... Maybe the Cabinet Secretary should be a little bit more reflective, given what she did have to say 3 weeks ago, forced into an emergency budget revision, having identified a £1 billion black hole, an emergency budget revision for the third time. And as the Fraser of Allender Institute, amongst others, have made clear, these cuts are a direct result of this government's decision-making. And there is an important contrast here. The UK government has had to make difficult decisions because of assumptions made by the previous government. Cynical assumptions that public sector pay could be held down to 2-3%. The SNP government have had to fix their own errors in their own budget, and what is worse, based on the same cynical assumptions about being able to hold public sector pay down to between 2-3%. But I tell you what, there's one big difference between the budget coming from the UK government and that of the Scottish government. We know one big fact about the Scottish government, as Alex Cole-Hamilton pointed out. Because of that £1 billion black hole, almost half of it was filled using non-recurring source of ScotWind. There is £500 million worth of cuts coming down the road in December. So if we want to talk about future, and I've given away plenty of times, Mr Mason, I'm afraid. If we want to talk about budgets ahead of time, perhaps the Scottish Government should come clean about where are those £500 million worth of cuts going to fall. The Scottish Government, the Scottish Government might want to focus on the jobs and opportunities that are being lost here because of the performance gap identified by the Fiscal Commission. £600 million simply because they failed to keep pace with the sluggish rate achieved by the last Conservative government. GDP per head across the UK has grown by just a mere 6% over the last 14 years of Conservative rule. Poor performance on growth has meant that wages today are barely more than they were in 2010. By comparison, if the UK had continued to grow at the same pace as it had in 2008, I don't have time, I'm afraid. Under a Labour government, real GDP capital would be £10,000 more per person than it is today. £10,000 per person. That is the cost of Conservative failure. That is the cost of Liz Truss's mini-budget. And that is the cost of reckless, unfunded tax cuts that sent the pound tumbling. And that is why we have had to make tough decisions to fix the £22 billion black hole left us by the last government. And let's look at that, because it's not just cynical pay increases, assumptions of pay increases. It was £6 billion on the asylum system. £6 billion that Jeremy Hunt tried to claim wouldn't need to be spent because Rwanda was going to work. It's ridiculous and it's shameless. £3 billion on real projects that they hadn't allocated the funding to. A commitment to spend on commitments that led to applying the National Reserve three times over. That is the inheritance that the last Conservative government left and the mess that the Labour government is having to fix. But let us also be clear. In order to fix that reckless inheritance, there can be no return to Conservative austerity. As the Chancellor laid clear yesterday, we need to look carefully about how we understand investment. And to quote her, it is time the Treasury moved on from just counting the costs of investment in our economy to recognising the benefits too. But it is vital that as we do so, that spending remains affordable, that borrowing remains affordable. To quote another fiscal rule, that the upper limit on debt servicing costs must allow explicit consideration of the sustainability of the stock of debt. That's not our fiscal rules. That's the SNP's fiscal rule, quote it from the last manifesto. So, absolutely, we can talk about investing, we can talk about the need to have a growing economy, but we must have a responsible approach to debt. And finally, we need to have an active industrial strategy that looks to drive growth. We need to secure long-term growth, we need to unlock investment and empower our nations and regions. And above all, we must ensure that there is no return to austerity under this UK Labour government. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr Johnson. I now call on Lauren Slater to speak to and to move Amendment 14614.1. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. 2 weeks ago, the UK Government's fiscal watchdog reported that the UK's finances are unsustainable, partly because the UK Government didn't have a credible plan for funding the costs associated with climate change. Governments have choices here. They can do as the Tories did and maintain that growth will solve all problems if only we cut taxes, environmental regulations and workers' rights enough. Only that didn't work. Britain's economy has suffered historically weak growth over the past 14 years. Austerity was a choice, and it didn't achieve that problem-solving growth. What it did was wreck public services, drive working people into desperation and poverty, and drive down investment in the UK compared to similar countries. A different choice can be made. We clearly desperately need an increase in public investment to get public services back on their feet and to tackle the climate and nature emergencies. Certainly.
Tanya Johnson.
So would she acknowledge that the £7.3 billion that we've pledged to the National Wealth Fund, the £8 billion for GB Energy, is that the source of investment in the growth that she's looking for?
Lauren Slater.
We look forward, of course, to seeing detailed plans for investment, but more specifically, how the incoming government intends to pay for these. I have some suggestions, because the UK government must look at the revenue-raising options of taxing polluters and the very wealthy. Indeed, one of the outcomes of the austerity years in the UK is that the wealth of billionaires and the super-rich has ballooned. Slow clap for the Tories for taking from the poor and giving to the mega-rich. Trickle-up economics is what we've had. We need to tax that money back into our economy. Windfall taxes are all very well, but a consistent approach to the taxation of big polluters to fund the transition to net zero would be more effective. Simply stopping tax breaks for oil and gas and aviation would be a start. Last week in this chamber, we all agreed that one of the best things we can do for small businesses is to ensure that big businesses pay fair taxes. The Observer found that Shell and BP paid no corporation tax or production levies on North Sea oil operations between 2018 and 2020, whilst claiming tax relief of nearly £400 million. How are small clean energy companies in the UK supposed to compete when big oil get massive tax breaks? Jet fuel has always been tax exempt in the UK. How are small, clean transportation businesses or publicly owned buses and trains supposed to compete with a polluting aviation industry which doesn't pay tax on its fuel? The UK needs to collect this money and revise the capital budget strategy to align with climate goals. We've got a whole bunch of stuff we need to build. Wind turbines, energy storage, grid infrastructure, train stations, hydrogen-powered buses, low-carbon homes. Let's get on with it. There is no shortage of money. Follow the trickle-up economics and tax dodgers to see where it's gone. I challenge the UK government to take a different approach. Rebalance the UK economy in favour of hope. Get money into the pockets of people who need it and can spend it. And don't be shy about making those who can and should contribute more do so. Our devolved government in Scotland has a role to play here too. The Scottish Government has not exhausted all our tools to address the current financial crisis. The Scottish Greens have been highly critical in recent weeks of some of the spending decisions which have been made by this government. Cuts to climate spending and the Nature Restoration Fund, the scrapping of policies to cut peak rail fares and to give free bus travel to asylum seekers have all been active decisions made by this government whilst protecting other areas of spending and maintaining tax cuts for businesses. We can't sit back and say this is all Westminster's fault when we're making decisions like these and failing to explore all options to establish sustainable revenue streams to support public services and investment. The Scottish Greens have a range of proposals for such solutions. There must be a strategic reprioritisation towards critical areas such as climate action, social security and public health, with a focus on efficiency and impact. I challenge the Scottish Government to review unconditional handouts to large landowners, putting money into unsustainable infrastructure projects like the A9 and the A96, and fossil fuel derivatives. Significant untapped revenue-raising opportunities include carbon emissions land tax, devolution of air passenger duty, reforms to NDR relief, landfill tax, and council tax. These should be pursued aggressively to create a more sustainable fiscal framework. Last week, a major report by Oxfam confirmed that bringing in the devolved air departure tax and using it to target private jets would raise enough money to permanently scrap peak rail fares, supporting more commuters to make the switch to low-carbon travel. Whilst the Scottish Greens were in government, development of a carbon land tax and cruise ship levy were well underway, as well as the long-overdue reforms to council tax. Would the Minister confirm in closing today what the Scottish Government's plans are now for these important measures? I think it's time to think again about taxation, and I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you, Ms. Leiter. I now call Alex Cole-Hamilton to speak to and to move Amendment 14614.4. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful for the opportunity to speak in this afternoon's debate, and I move the amendment in my name. Presiding Officer, at the UK general election in July, the people sent a message. They rendered a judgment, both to the Conservative government, of course, but yes, to the SNP government at Holyrood as well. That message was clear and it was unequivocal. People want things to be done differently. They are tired of the old politics. But the early days of this UK Labour administration will not have given them comfort as yet. I hope that changes. We need the narrative to shift. We need some hope in our politics and in our country. And while the Conservatives fight amongst themselves, the Liberal Democrats will act as a constructive opposition, both in this place and on the green benches at Westminster, working in the national interest to hold this new UK government to account. We will support it where we agree, look to improve Labour's plans when we feel they lack ambition, and to oppose them when they think that they are wrong. That is our responsibility and it is our job. A responsible opposition is an essential role in any democracy, and there are now a record 72 Liberal Democrat MPs to do that, the largest third party in a century, ready to champion our policies and to hold that government to account. Those strong Liberal opposition voices will be louder and more important than ever before. Presiding Officer, there's no time to waste in the reparation of the damage done by years of chaos at the heart of Number 10. It is perhaps surprising, therefore, that the chaos and the inheritance is not something widely addressed in the Scottish Government's motion. They do not reference the context of the disastrous state the Conservative Party have left the nation's finances in. I understand why, but it is important that we contextualise the debate and frame it in that way. Nor would you know it from Murdo Fraser's amendment either. It doesn't often offer any hint of contrition. It makes no mention of Liz Truss, the Prime Minister, and an agenda that both he and Russell Finlay championed in this place, who crashed the economy, sent mortgages through the roof, sent gilts into apoplexy and cost our country untold billions. So looking ahead to the UK budget, what would Liberal Democrats do differently? Well, the top priority of the new Labour administration's first UK budget must be fixing the NHS across these islands. Whilst policy for this vital area of public service is devolved to this chamber, there is much that the UK government has at its disposal that it can do to improve the context here. The Prime Minister recently promised a 10-year plan for the NHS, but without the pledge of any additional funding. Our health service needs reform, of course it does, but reform alone won't be enough to replace ageing equipment, to fix crumbling hospitals, to relieve pressure on our health service so that it will allow people to see a GP at the first time of asking. We need proper investment as well as reform, or the crisis will get only worse. In particular, the reinstatement of capital funding. We've heard the government repeat time and again that the cuts to the capital budget that they received from Westminster is the reason for the hard stop on so many aspects of our health service, whether that's the reprovisioning of the Princess Alexandra Eye Pavilion, the National Treatment Service, I could go on, the Belford Hospital in Fort William. But with that latitude, that extra extension of funding, those projects can continue. I do not excuse the Scottish Government, though, for their role in our Scottish health crisis, but there are certainly keys towards its resolution and salvation available to this UK Labour government, and we need that. That's so necessary. RCN Scotland's intervention today was clear that patient care is daily being compromised. And I agree also with them on another point, because they said that good care costs, but missed care costs more. Our own ministers can invest to save by investing in public health and early access to GPs, pharmacists and dentists, so fewer people need to go to hospital in the first place. But there are steps that the UK government can also do. We need to fix the crisis in social care. We do that, we can stop people being stuck in hospital beds. And we know, presiding officer, that any given night in Scotland there are 2,000 patients well enough to go home but too frail to do so without a care package to receive them. So we need to make social care a profession of choice again. And Liberal Democrats across the United Kingdom have urged the UK government at this budget to create a new national minimum wage of £2 higher than the national average for our nation's carers, to make that a profession of choice. And by helping people to stay healthy for longer, we can bring down waiting lists, get people back to work, and we can give the economy the boost it needs too. Liberal Democrats are clear on what the people's priorities are because we've asked them and we've listened to them, door by door and street by street. And those people are telling us now that the Labour Party has got it wrong, particularly on their decision to retain the two-child benefit cap, something that our MPs walked through the lobbies of Westminster with their MPs to originally oppose in 2016, which plunges thousands of children into poverty. They've got it wrong on scrapping the winter fuel payments for pensioners, just as bills are set to rise again in the teeth of winter. Hundreds of thousands should be on pension credit, but are not. That is the wrong way of means testing this. I also remember, as many will others, the days of the cold weather payments brought in to stop the body count, the annual body count of pensioners who died because they felt uncomfortable or unable to switch the household heating on. We would raise billions of pounds in tax revenues in a fair way by reversing Conservative administration's tax cuts for the big banks, close loopholes on capital gains exploited by the very wealthiest people of the top 0.1%, and tax the social media giants, presiding officer, make sure they pay their fair share and hypothecate that revenue to absolutely pump prime our investment in mental health services, because it is the social media giants who do so much of the harm to our young people. That would in turn lead to consequentials that we would spend here. I think I'm running out of time, presiding officer, but Liberal Democrats will be a responsible opposition in this Parliament. We will urge the Labour government to be bolder. We will tell it when it's wrong, and we will support them when they think we've got it right. That is what constructive opposition looks like. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Cole-Hamilton. And we now move to the open debate. Backbench speeches of up to 6 minutes. There is no time in hand, and any interventions must therefore be absorbed within the member's time allocation. I call Kevin Stewart to be followed by Douglas Lumsden. Mr. Stewart.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And first of all, can I welcome the decision to locate GB Energy to Aberdeen, that announcement that was made this afternoon. It was the only logical choice, and we await the detail with some interest. I have to say, Presiding Officer, that I disagree with the remarks by Daniel Johnson that 5 weeks before a budget is not the time to discuss it. Now is exactly the right time to discuss it. And I can tell Mr. Johnson and the Chamber that the forthcoming budget is the talk of the steamy in my ERTs and PERTs. I met with academics at the University of Aberdeen on Friday to discuss energy. And the focus was, what is Ms. Reeves going to do in her budget? Because there is, in Aberdeen, amongst industry, amongst the unions, amongst academics, a real worry around about the decisions that Ms. Reeves will make on oil and gas. And it is not often that I agree with Murdo Fraser, but the allowances regime is extremely important to the oil and gas industry. And I am really concerned if Labour MPs, the Chancellor, the Prime Minister, doesn't start listening, then we may well see a flight of capital and the demise of the North Sea industry before a just transition. And I'll take Mr. Kerr.
Liam Kerr.
Mr. Stewart, and actually I associate myself with much of what he's said so far. It has been said that Labour's policies could cost tens of thousands of jobs up in the North East. They've said GB Energy will come up to Aberdeen. Does he know how many jobs that might provide?
Kevin Stewart.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. As I laid out at the very beginning, I think we need to see the detail on GB Energy. We don't know how many jobs that will provide. But we do know from Unite the Union that if Labour carries on with the policies that they have got on the table so far, that will lead to 30,000 job losses, according to Unite the Union. And of course, others say that there could be up to 100,000 job losses if we do not get this right. Now, renewables is our future, but we require a just transition, and we require oil and gas for some years to come. The Chancellor must listen and must get this right. I also, in the past couple of days, have spoken to the housing sector. I met yesterday with the Chief Executive of the Scottish Federation of Housing Associations. Again, the budget was at the forefront of those discussions because they, like many others, want to see investment in capital. And we know that we have had our capital budget slashed by £1.5 billion, and we have had the financial transactions budget, the loans budget, slashed dramatically by some 62%, if I remember rightly. The housing sector and others want to see investment in capital, and I hope Ms Reeves listens to that. And of course, the other things which are on the mind of many of my constituents is some of the nonsenses that have gone on of late. Free gear keir is definitely the talk of the steamy, and all of his freebies are at top of the agenda in any pub, cafe or community discussion. And while Labour MPs seem to be happy about this freebie situation, people cannot understand why this is happening at a time where vital benefits are being cut, public services are being cut, and the most vulnerable in our society are being affected while folk get free suits, free glasses, free hospitality, and the list goes on. That needs to stop. Labour promised change, Presiding Officer, during the course of the election. What people did not expect was change for the worse, and that is what has happened thus far. Also, we had the Labour leader in this Parliament, Anna Sarwar, saying during the course of that election, and I quote, "Read my lips, no austerity under Labour." That has gone at the very beginning with the massive cuts to winter fuel payments, which is austerity on steroids. And in terms of my constituents, 8,021 of them will lose winter fuel payments because of that dire decision by the Labour Party. Very briefly.
Briefly, Jack Hintonburg. We need a microphone card in, please, briefly. Thank you.
Thank you. My apologies. Would the member agree with me that it is vital? The reason it's so vital for the winter fuel payment is that even today, Aberdeen sits at 9 degrees, Westminster sits at 17 degrees, and that is what we are facing in Scotland. We actually have lower temperatures.
And bring your remarks to close, please, Mr.
I will do, Presiding Officer. Yes, I agree completely with that. And I know that over 13,000 folk in Ms. Dunbar's constituency will lose their payments. Presiding Officer, cutting services and support for the most vulnerable is a choice that Labour have made. It is not the choice of the SNP. It is not the choice of Scotland. And it shouldn't be the choice of Westminster either. In this budget, the Chancellor can choose a different path, a path that doesn't follow Tory austerity rules. And I hope that she chooses to make a difference.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart. I now call Douglas Lumsden to be followed by Claire Hawley. Mr. Lumsden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We're here to debate the priorities of Scotland, but it's clear that the SNP have no idea what the priorities of the Scottish people are. Time after time, we have witnessed ministers announce new policies, legislation and vanity projects, only for them to be forced into a U-turn when they discover that they've got their sums wrong. The reintroduction of peak fares on ScotRail and the scrapping of their commitment on free school meals being the latest examples of that. This is a government that continues to pour taxpayers' money down the drain with unnecessary and unwanted independence papers that even Humza Yousaf admits that no one reads, while failing to provide some of the most basic public services or deliver on promises that it has repeatedly made during its time in power. And, Presiding Officer, if you were to ask the people that live and work in the north-east of Scotland for their priorities, I'm sure they would tell you it would be to finally see this government deliver on what it has continually promised and consistently failed to deliver for the region. For example, dualling the A96, still not done. The promise to dual the A90 north of Elland by 2025, still nothing. Or the promise made 8 years ago to spend £200 million to cut rail journey times between the North East and the Central Belt by 20 minutes. Not a second of journey times and barely any of the money promised committed to make such a vital improvement for the people of the North East. A list of broken promises by this devolved government. And the Labour government are no better. Their honeymoon period has resulted in the callous decision to rip away the winter fuel payment from those who have worked and contributed their entire lives to this country, while simultaneously handing over inflation-busting pay rises to their union paymasters. And sadly, it appears that this failing devolved government is meekly following suit. Across Scotland, communities are no stranger to the cold. Indeed, it is Braemar in the north-east that currently holds the joint coldest temperature record in the UK of a chilling minus 20 degrees in 1982. But across the northeast of Scotland, over 128,000 pensioners are having their winter fuel payments snatched from them. This winter, pensioners the length and breadth of this country are going to freeze in their homes thanks to the decisions made by the parties opposite. And let us be clear, these are political decisions made by the Labour and SNP governments that reveal their true colours and what they view as priorities. And how about prioritising our energy industry? How about prioritising the thousands of oil and gas workers who are facing a future of uncertainty and the inevitable job losses resulting from the hostility of this devolved government and the extremists they invited into Bute House? Meanwhile, we now have a Labour government that has placed the likes of Ed Miliband in charge of our energy security, a man who seems intent on destroying the north-east of Scotland. Both parties have insisted on prioritising the premature decline of our oil and gas industry, slamming our region with increased taxation, without a single thought for the economy of the north-east and the impact that these economically and environmentally illiterate positions will have on thousands of families across the region. I'll give it to Daniel Johnson.
Daniel Johnson.
So, look, the member's absolutely right about the criticality of the energy sector. Would he recognise we've already lost around 30,000 jobs over the last decade, and with no other interventions, we would continue to see a decline between 5 and 15%. Regardless of what, this is about managing the transition and ensuring there's an investment. Would he at least concede that point, even if he disagrees with the detail of how we're trying to produce it?
Douglas Lumsden.
I thank for the intervention, but it's also about managing the decline. And that's what Labour Party seems to be not doing just now. They want to accelerate that decline and see thousands of jobs lost right across the North East. And in June, a poll showed that 75% of Scots back our oil and gas industry. That's because the Scottish people have the common sense to understand the impact to the environment and the economy of stopping domestic production before we have reduced demand. Sadly, the sense that the Scottish people have seems far less common in the parties opposite. And, Presiding Officer, representing the north-east of Scotland, I feel that we are suffering from a double whammy, not just the destruction of the oil and gas industry, but also the constant raiding of the rural budget is having a hugely negative impact. £32 million cut from forestry grant scheme, £5 million from Nature Restoration Fund, £33 million agricultural support funded from the Bew Review snatched from our farmers. The rural sector is key to our economy and also our drive towards net zero, but toward seems to be an easy target for this central belt biased SNP government. I'll give way.
Mary Gujon, briefly.
truth into this situation here. Money is not missing. The money was ring-fenced and it will be returned to the portfolio. Would he like to account for the £358 million that DEFRA didn't spend in the UK on their agricultural budget?
Douglas Lumsden.
So here we have it. We know that the £33 million BEW money has been taken. And there's no timetable of when that money is going to be returned back to our farmers. Presiding officer, the Scottish people know that strong public services have to be paid for. You need a thriving economy and an environment that increases opportunities for employment. You need a government and policies that help that economy grow. Yet in Scotland, we have seen a government that, since using devolved income tax powers, have cost the country over £500 million in lost revenue in 22-23 alone. This, coupled with the £2.7 billion over the course of this Parliament that has been wasted on botched schemes such as the failed ferry fiasco. Money is tight, presiding officer, but only because of the SNP's financial incompetence. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Claire Hawkey to be followed by Neil Bibby, up to 6 minutes, Ms Hawkey.
Thank you, presiding officer. This past weekend, what commentators predicted would be a victory lap for the new UK Labour government at the party conference has been overshadowed by fights, fallouts and scandal. Whilst the new Deputy Prime Minister was telling our party's conference that now is our moment, major trade unions were reeling against their first steps in office. And what first steps they have been. Cutting winter fuel payments from 10 million pensioners in England and Wales, over 800,000 in Scotland and over 50,000 from South Lanarkshire, where my Rutherglen constituency is based. The General Secretary of Unite, Sharon Graham, did not mince her words when she described the cuts as cruel, saying the Chancellor was picking the pockets of pensioners whilst leaving the wealthiest pretty much untouched. The new Prime Minister has admitted that there was no impact assessment ahead of the decision to strip this payment. Incredulously, he added that the UK government was not legally required to produce one. I'm sure that members across the chamber will agree with me that the Prime Minister's statement that he slashed the payment with a heavy heart is of no comfort to our constituents, desperately worried about how they're going to get through the winter, and not least because the energy price cap is set to rise next month, adding an additional 10% to their fuel bills. Presiding officer, the Prime Minister's hand-wringing does not wash with my constituents, and it certainly does not wash with me. The message from every single member of this Parliament should be crystal clear today. The cut to the winter fuel payment is unreasonable, it's cruel, and the UK government should reverse it immediately. Of course, when there was a flicker of rebellion amongst Labour MPs at Westminster, it was squashed immediately. When the SNP MPs tabled an amendment to immediately abolish the two-child benefit cap, only 7 Labour MPs put their heads above the parapet and voted with them. Not a single Scottish Labour MP joined them. 1 in 9 families across the UK are now affected by the two-child cap, a rise from previous figures. Limiting the support available to families with more than 2 children has been widely recognised as the key driver of child poverty. The Chief Executive of the Child Poverty Action Group, Alison Graham, has stated that it makes life harder for kids by punishing them for having brothers and sisters. Less than an hour after that Westminster vote concluded, the whip was removed from 7 MPs. A ruthless move from a ruthless Prime Minister. And, Presiding Officer, I would say to my Labour colleagues today, if so few of your MP colleagues are prepared to do the right thing, all eyes are now on you, all 3 of you who have turned up today. As Alison Graham from CPAC also stated, children are losing their life chances to the two-child limit now, and they can't wait for the new government to align every star before the policy is scrapped. The two-child cap is keeping families in poverty, and the UK government must use their first budget to scrap it immediately. Before the general election, Scots were promised a Labour government that would give the Scotland Office £150 million to tackle poverty. And with the then Shadow Scottish Secretary Ian Murray appearing on the front page of newspapers saying it was the change Scotland can get. Confusingly, the new Scottish Secretary, the very same Ian Murray, then said last weekend that the £150 million figure was made up before retracting that claim and admitting he doesn't have the cash in a war chest. The change Scotland has seen instead has been a £160 million cut to the Scottish Government budget before the UK Government budget has been announced. And in this context, it is little wonder that prominent economists are sounding the alarm before the UK budget, calling for the brakes to be put on the vicious cycle of underinvestment and the continuation of Tory fiscal rules and austerity. The call is also coming from inside the House. One of the seven suspended Labour MPs, Richard Bergin, did manage to speak at a Labour conference fringe event, and he warned against the UK government heeding the siren voices on the political right in the media for austerity and for cuts to living standards, and pleaded with the new government to make a fresh start on living standards and the funding of public services. Now, given all that I've described and all that we've seen so far, I'm afraid that his words might be in vain. As a constituent related to me just last week, the Labour Party continued to hammer a message of change on social media and in the press. Now, for many of my constituents, there has indeed been change, but that change has been for the worst. Let us be under no illusion about what's happening now. The new Labour government are publicly laying the groundwork for another brutal round of austerity. It may not be what they call it, but that's what it is. 14 years of Westminster failure has left public services in the UK at breaking point. The SNP government in Scotland continues to push at the constraints of devolution, from delivering a game-changing policy like the Scottish Child Payment to spending millions of pounds to mitigate punitive UK policies like the bedroom tax. But it's impossible to mitigate everything, and Westminster's painful economic decisions severely impact the Scottish government's spending powers. Since their election, the UK government has dodged and brushed off scrutiny, rolled back on promises and slashed budgets. Labour's cuts have been a political choice. When their budget is delivered in October, they have the opportunity to deliver the change they promised, and they must take ownership of the privilege of office that has been handed to them and put an end to the politics of austerity once and for all.
Thank you. I now call Neil Bibby, who joins us remotely, to be followed by Colette Stevens in up to 6 minutes. Mr. Bibby.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, for the opportunity to speak in this debate. The budget on the 30th of October will be a significant event. It will be the first budget of the new Labour government after 14 years of Tory economic mismanagement. And it will also be historically significant too, as Rachel Reeves will make the first budget as a female Chancellor of the Exchequer. The 4th of December will also be an important date, indeed arguably the most important date in the Scottish parliamentary calendar, when Shona Robinson gives her budget statement. It, though, will be far less unique in that it will be the SNP government's 17th budget in a row. Perhaps the key difference between the two, though, is that it is our job as the Scottish Parliament to hold the Scottish government to account on the latter, not to grandstand on the former. Presiding Officer, the phrase "I will take no lectures" is frequently heard in this chamber, and I don't think I'm alone in saying, thinking it is overused. But really, what else are we meant to say to this SNP government when they try and tell anyone how to manage the public's finances? Presiding Officer, this SNP government needs to get its own house in order before telling anyone else what to do. Because the reality is that people in Scotland are paying more and getting less under this Scottish government. Working people in Scotland earning just £29,000 are paying more in income tax than their counterparts in the rest of the UK. And similar to the Tories, this government has wasted billions of pounds of Scottish taxpayers' money since they came to power because of their incompetence. And that's before you get to the pet projects and you get to the gimmicks. And public services are getting weaker as a result. The SNP under John Swinney, Kate Forbes and now Shona Robinson have spent budget after budget failing to focus on growing the economy, never mind delivering it, and we are now paying the price for that failure. Since 2014, according to the Office of National Statistics, GDP per head in Scotland has grown by just 4.3% compared to the rest of the UK that has grown by 6%. That's just over two-thirds of the UK's growth rate over the last decade. And that has consequences, consequences for our economy, consequences for living standards, and consequences for the Scottish Government's budget. And those consequences have been laid out by the Scottish Fiscal Commission, who have said that if the Scottish economy has simply matched economic performance of the rest of the UK since income tax was devolved in 2016, then the Scottish budget would be significantly better off. Graeme Roy of the Commission told the Finance Committee this month that, and I quote, because of the relatively slower growth in the Scottish economy since income tax was devolved, we estimate that the economic performance gap means that the net position in 2022-23 was around £624 million lower than it would have been had Scottish economic performance matched that of the rest of the UK. And this leads, for example, to the SNP making decisions to abandon policies such as free school meals for all primary age children and reintroducing peak fares, things they don't want to talk about today. And let's not forget, Presiding Officer, the people of Scotland less than 12 weeks ago gave their verdict on the Tories and the SNP and supported the election of the new UK Labour government and 37 Scottish Labour MPs. And I would say to the SNP, if they wish to spend time discussing the UK budget, that is of course their prerogative, but it's for their 9 MPs at Westminster, what's left of them, to take that forward. Scottish Labour MPs and the new UK Labour government have been clear what their number one priority is, and that is economic growth. Economic growth that the SNP and Green Scottish government for nearly 3 years couldn't even agree on the concept of, let alone deliver in any way that could be seen as a priority. The new UK Labour government, meanwhile, is focused on fixing the foundations to create economic growth so we can raise living standards for everyone and we can rebuild the public finances to invest in public services. That will be the budget priority. And as Daniel Johnson mentioned earlier, the Chancellor of the Exchequer was clear yesterday that there will be no return to austerity. Although we should not underestimate the legacy that's been left to the new government by the Tories. Murdo Fraser mentioned borrowing. Borrowing is more than double it was before the pandemic, but overall debt is now nearly 100% of GDP, the highest levels since the 1960s. Before the election, the previous Conservative government did not factor in an impact of a series of new challenging pressures on the public finances. Spending commitments were made without funding being behind them. And as Daniel Johnson said, wrong assumptions were made about this year's public sector pay award. So difficult decisions may need to be made. Politics is about choices, but this budget is an opportunity to start to turn the page on years of economic mismanagement and for the new government to deliver on our manifesto commitments. Presiding Officer said earlier that the new Labour government's top priority is economic growth, and key to achieving that will be fixing the foundations of the economy. The UK government may have changed, but it's clear that the SNP approach remains the same: blame someone else for their own failures, mismanagement and incompetence. This debate has been another attempt to distract from those failures. In closing, Presiding Officer, I said earlier we do hear the phrase take no lectures too often in the chamber. The one phrase we never hear, though, from both the SNP and indeed the Tories is mea culpa. And perhaps we should hear that more often when discussing the current state of our public finances.
Thank you, Mr. Bibby. And I call Colette Stevenson to be followed by Mark Griffin. Up to 6 minutes, Ms. Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Given Scotland's budget is tied to decisions on public spending by the UK government south of the border, I'm sure members across the chamber will recognise the importance of the upcoming UK budget. As Labour Minister Wes Streeton said, all roads lead to Westminster because decisions taken there have an impact on every part of the UK, regardless of devolution. In the past few years, Scotland has been dragged out of the European Union against our will. We've had to endure prime ministers like Boris Johnson and Liz Truss that people in Scotland did not vote for. We've lived through a pandemic and we're still suffering from the Westminster cost of living crisis. And as the Finance Secretary highlighted, prominent economists, including Glasgow University Principal Professor Anton Muscatelli, are asking the UK Government to stop the underinvestment that has resulted in a vicious circle of stagnation and decline. We faced over a decade of austerity under the last Conservative government, and despite their protestations, Labour are continuing this by keeping Tory fiscal rules. But Labour should learn the lessons of the past 14 years and not repeat the same damaging mistakes as the Tories. Now is the time for UK Labour government, which has all the economic levers necessary to invest in our people and our public services. In a briefing published yesterday, the Joseph Rowntree Foundation was clear that this is essential because business as usual economic growth in the UK will not reduce poverty. Similarly, Shelter Scotland was very clear in its key asks of the UK government: end austerity, scrap the benefit cap, the bedroom tax and the two-child limit, and increase Scotland's capital budget. Those are simple, reasonable calls for me. With all the powers that the Westminster Treasury has, those should be easy choices for the UK government to make. But instead, we are told by Keir Starmer that his first budget is going to be painful. Presiding officer, the SNP is calling on the UK government to scrap the two-child cap and reinstate the winter fuel payment for pensioners. But Scottish Labour are today arguing against those ideas. Not content with continuing cruel Tory policies like the two-child cap and austerity fiscal rules, Keir Starmer's government has gone further and taken the winter fuel payment from thousands of vulnerable pensioners. Rather than delivering change, the UK Labour government is shortchanging the people of Scotland. The Labour amendment is also full of hubris. Back in Downing Street for 5 minutes, it seems Labour are already taking voters for granted. That arrogance is the mistake Labour made in Scotland in 2007, and it's why they are currently the third party in this Parliament. In fact, recent polling shows that most voters think that the Labour government is just as bad or worse than the last Tory government, while Keir Starmer's approval ratings are at their lowest level ever, at minus 26. Furthermore, than half of voters in Scotland think that the Labour government is not acting in the best interests of Scotland, and a majority oppose Labour's cuts to winter fuel payments. If Labour politicians don't want to listen to reasonable calls from SNP politicians or from experts and stakeholders, perhaps they should reflect on those poll findings and listen to the electorate, many of whom lent them a vote to kick out the Tories. To conclude, Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government motion for today's debate should not be controversial for any MSP who believes in fairness and social justice. Those of us in the SNP are quite clear that the Labour government in Westminster must scrap cruel Tory policies like the two-child cap and the bedroom tax, and they must put an end to the Conservative fiscal rules that underpin austerity. If these measures are still in place after Labour's first budget in October, then those policies will become Labour's rate clause, Labour's bedroom tax and Labour's austerity. With policy choices like that alongside the cuts to winter fuel payments, it's clear that Labour, from cradle to grave, does not serve the people of Scotland. In contrast, the SNP is invested in the people of Scotland. In government, the SNP has created the game-changing Scottish Child Payment, championed the rollout of the Real Living Wage, expanded access to free personal care, and delivered free bus travel for under-22s, alongside older and disabled people. The SNP Scottish Government will always do its best with the powers that it has, but with Westminster decisions continuing to make life more difficult for households, communities and businesses, it's clear that independence is a vital necessity for Scotland.
Thank you. I now call Mark Griffin to be followed by Christine Graham. Up to 6 minutes, Mr Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want to start the debate with the assumption that the Government has brought this debate to the floor of the Chamber, in good faith to debate the budget priorities of the Labour government. And if that is the case, the Cabinet Secretary, maybe she can catch up when she comes back, would be in a position to take a clear-eyed look at where the UK's bank balance has been left by the outgoing Conservative government. Because, Presiding Officer, it's not that the Tories just dipped into the country's overdraft to get through a tight spot in the hope or the knowledge that they could pay it back later. The Tories drove a horse and cart to the country's overdraft limit and kept going and kept going and kept going. The Treasury had a £9 billion reserve. I'm spoilt for choice here, so I'll take Mr McKee.
Well, thank you very much.
Minister.
Mark Griffin's gone on about the overdraft, as he calls it. It was inherited by this UK Labour government. Why is it that they went through, Labour Party went through the general election denying, despite us telling them and others telling them and experts telling them, there was a £20 billion black hole in the finances, and as soon as they get into power, they recognise that there is indeed a £20 billion hole in the public finances?
Mark Griffin.
I think the Labour Party were clear through the general election that there were going to be tough decisions as a result of the mess the Conservatives had left. What we didn't realise was just how bad that mess was going to be. That's something that's been set out as the Chancellor set out that immediate review by the Treasury. It's something that BBC Verify have confirmed as well. It's something that OBR have confirmed. But the reason that the Conservatives, the reason the Tories committed to spending that money was because they knew there was no way they would ever be asked to pay that back. And now the country finds itself with that £22 billion bill.
Brian Whittle.
Very grateful to Mr Griffin for giving way. I didn't hear him complaining much when the Conservative government spent £400 billion in the furlough scheme, making sure that our businesses in Britain would still be there after the COVID pandemic.
Mark Griffin.
I mean, I think we're comparing apples and oranges here. Of course we didn't complain when the government spent money on furlough. We did complain when the government spent a ridiculous sum of money on the Rwanda scheme that we knew was never going to come to fruition and just saw taxpayers' money march right out the country. Now, Labour will fix the mess, the £22 billion mess that this Conservative government has left, not because it's easy, not because it will win us elections or make us more popular, because some things are just more important, because it's the right thing to do. And because by taking some tough decisions now, but I'm sorry, Mr Stewart, I've taken a number of interventions and I'm halfway through my time already, but by taking those tough decisions now, by getting our public finances under control and offering stability after years of chaos, we can maximise the chances for spreading fairness and opportunity across the country for the next five. And I want to assume that the government has any intention of suggesting ways of helping to fix the foundation of our economy that helps us get out of that black hole, because this government has been in power for 17 years. So what advice then could the government offer the new Chancellor? With the government having delivered three emergency in-year budget cuts in a row, what wisdom is this government best placed to pass on financial management, sound decision-making to the new Chancellor? The Chancellor has talked about removing waste by removing spending on consultancy and refusing to pay any more money towards dodgy COVID contracts the Tories gave their friends, and by vowing to recoup that money. The SNP has 17 years of failed financial interventions, incompetence, waste and inefficiency to look back on, and this wasted money has come at a price, over £5 billion of taxpayers' money. When it comes to offering suggestions and learning lessons, I would suggest that this government could take a page out of the new Chancellor's book rather than the other way round. Rachel Reeves spoke about the fundamental link between economic growth and housing for everyone. Labour has already begun to deliver on that commitment to build 1.5 million homes through the course of this parliamentary term. In contrast, the Scottish Government can point to the Government's decisions to strip affordable housing budgets, which has seen today the worst homelessness figures on record. 10,000 children in temporary accommodation, housing starts and completions at the lowest level in years. That is the SNP's financial decisions, the inefficiency, the waste, the mismanagement coming home to roost, and it's the children in temporary accommodation that are paying the price for that. Now, to govern is to choose, and yes, the Chancellor has made difficult decisions, but she has had to. But they will mean that when the foundations of the economy have been rebuilt, Britain's public services, NHS and people's mortgage payments can never, ever be in the danger that Liz Truss and the Tories put them in, and that the Chancellor has been clear that there will be no return to austerity, that budgets will grow. So, Presiding Officer, let's assume again that this debate hasn't been a wasted parliamentary time attempting to distract voters from the Government's ever-increasing list of abject failures. Let's assume there was merit in discussing the priorities of a budget that hasn't been published yet. But we can't assume, can we, because this is the real world, and, Presiding Officer, this country is crying out for change after years and years of SNP and Tory failure. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Griffin. I now call Christine Graham to be followed by John Mason. Up to 6 minutes, Ms Graham.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I say to Mark Griffin, speaking up for Scotland's pensioners is never wasted time. In 2005, when Labour and the Lib Dems were in power here, and they were also in power at Westminster, they led a debate on closing the opportunity gap. I focused on pensioner poverty, with one in five then living in poverty. Then, as now, the solution was a decent state pension. That, of course, as with my state pension, is subject to tax, if relevant. But then, as now, the UK state pension, compared to other European nations, is abysmal. Norway, Netherlands and Iceland, for example. Then, as now, UK pensioners were forced to claim pension credit. Then, as now, the figure of those not claiming was over 30%. Some 20 years on, the figure for non-claimants is just under 40%. It has increased. So Labour knew then, as they know now, those figures, and these were no doubt factored into the savings they would make, knowing that millions of pensioners will fall foul of pension credit rules. That was bad enough, but now it denies them the very basic right to their winter fuel payment. The online application form is bad enough, but here is the paper form. All 24 pages of form with 24 pages of notes. And here are some samples of the questions. Page 23, have you claimed tax credits in the last 12 months? Page 23, no. Then you go to question 102. Same page. Question 111, do you or your partner pay ground rent for the place you live, where you live? If you answer yes, please send us proof. There are loads of questions like that. Bewildering. No wonder people don't fill it in. It is set up for people to fail to claim. Here, and no wonder they're desperately low. On top of that, if you survive the application form to get to the very end of 24 pages, you might just be above the cut-off point. By the way, when I received my winter fuel payment, like many other comfortably off pensioners, rather than return it to the Treasury, I donated it to charities, many of them necessary because of successive decades of austerity. Now, according to Independent Age, in my constituency, 1,445 do not claim. In terms of homes, 92 in Midlothian will go cold just because they don't claim pension credit, and 133 in the Borders. And, of course, that's only those entitled to pension credit. To add insult to energy-rich Scotland, we have higher energy costs, colder, longer, dark winters, losing this vital support as a result of a cruel policy dreamed up in the balmy home counties. Oddly enough, if you live abroad, you'll still get your pension winter fuel payment if you claim a pension credit. Maybe we should all be moving to sunny Spain. In Scotland, seriously, there will be excess illnesses and even deaths. Shame on Labour. Labour that I thought was for the people, it's not for the people. not for the people. They look after themselves, but they look after Scotland's pensioners. And shame on the 37 Scottish Labour MPs who know the score but failed to speak up for Scotland's pensioners. No need to wonder why there wasn't a single cheep about this in their manifesto when they obviously had it planned. If it had been in their manifesto, I don't think there'd be 37 Scottish Labour MPs.
Thank you. I now call John Mason, who will be the final speaker in the open debate, after which we will move to closing speeches. Mr Mason, up to 6 minutes, please.
Well, thank you very much for the opportunity to speak today. It's good to have a bit more freedom now that I'm technically an independent. And I am, I think, the only member for the Finance Committee is here, but I do not pretend to speak for the Finance Committee. Now, as we consider the upcoming UK budget, there are some issues which deal with the here and now, impacting the Scottish budget for 24-25 and 25-26. But it would also be good to hear from the Chancellor about longer-term major changes which would benefit both Scotland and the UK. To start on a positive note, I would certainly welcome suggestions from Rachel Reeves herself that, as the first female Chancellor, she would seek to improve life for women and close the gender pay gap. She has said she would provide a funding pool for female-founded businesses following the review by Dame Alison Rose, and that sounds good. As the Scottish Government motion says, we particularly need to see more investment in public infrastructure and in projects that support the transition to net zero. The immediate question then is, where should that money come from? UK borrowing is already very high at some £2.7 trillion, which is around £49,000 per head of population. However, I think an argument can be made for more borrowing specifically for capital expenditure. If we spend money on house building, these would last for 50 years or more, so it is reasonable to borrow for a purpose like that, and that money will be repaid over the course of these houses' lifetime. However, I am much less keen on borrowing for day-to-day spending. All that does is pass the cost of our current expenditure onto our children and grandchildren for them to pay. That is not right or fair. We are a rich country, whether that be Scotland or the UK, and we should be paying today what today's costs are, not leaving it to future generations to pick up the bill. Yes, many people are impacted by the cost of living crisis, but let's remember that many people are not affected. We see restaurants which are frequently packed out. Just last Wednesday, after the independence rally, two of us went up for a meal about 9 p.m. and had to queue for a table. Some restaurants in my constituency are so busy that you always have to book ahead. We are told that some 200,000 Scots travelled to Germany for the Euros, and people are spending large sums for Taylor Swift and Oasis tickets. So yes, some people are short of money, but some of us have much more money than we need. We could be paying more in tax. Therefore, when it comes to this year's and next year's UK budget, I would very much support a universal winter fuel payment. After all, we know that many pensioners in need are not claiming the pension credit, as Christine Graham so eloquently said, that they're entitled to, so it cannot be right to use pension credit as a test of need. Similarly, Westminster should get rid of the two-child limit. Apart from anything else, we need more children, not least so that in future we have more people of working age. We should be doing all we can, as the Scottish Government is doing with the Scottish Child Payment, to encourage larger families. And another very justifiable UK change would be reduced VAT for building, repairs and maintenance. So if this resource or day-to-day spending is not to be paid for by borrowing or by cuts to other parts of the budget, how are they to be paid for? It seems to me logically by raising taxes as a whole, and we had some suggestions from the Greens on that. The UK is a relatively low-tax country in comparison to our neighbours. There are different measures, but according to the OECD and Eurostat, our tax-to-GDP ratio is 34%, compared to Netherlands and Germany at 39%, France at 45%, and Denmark at 47%. The Conservatives tell us we need to be competitive, by which they mean having low taxes. But there is also the sense of being competitive in having better schools, better health services, and better care for the elderly. The UK is not currently competitive in that regard. There are various ways in which the UK could be raising more money. Capital gains tax could be raised, including on homes. Is it not unfair that homeowners can make big gains on their homes tax-free, while tenants have no such possibility? So the gap between the richer and the poorer inevitably gets wider. National insurance stops at age 66. So I am not paying any national insurance, and neither is Christine Graham. How can that be right? Someone earning less than I am, but with many family commitments, very quickly.
It's just, to say you actually don't benefit because your tax goes up accordingly.
John Mason.
Okay, well, we'll deal with that another time. But but the point still is that national insurance could should continue up with age, and the Chancellor could change that. And thirdly, how about tax on wealth? If Labour really wants to reduce the gap between the richest and the poorest, then surely wealth needs to be taxed to a much greater extent. However, as well as these relatively short-term adjustments, we could do with some more fundamental changes to the UK tax system. We could combine income tax and national insurance to create a much simpler and progressive system. My own suggestion would be to start at a combined rate of 10% and then go up to, say, 20% and 30% and so on. Another suggestion would be to make rates for income tax, capital gains tax and corporation tax much more similar to each other, and that would take away the artificial incentives for individuals to incorporate and similar tax avoidance measures. And both of these would make it much simpler for the devolved parliaments to use tax themselves. But finally, to end on a more positive note, I welcome the suggestions from Labour that they would introduce multi-year funding as the norm. That will help all Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland to budget ourselves. It cannot be right that during an actual fiscal year, Westminster starts spending more money, be it on a pay increase or whatever, and effectively we have to match that by making cuts or elsewhere. So we await the UK budget on the 30th of October. I confess I am not optimistic, and I fear that Scotland will be left to pick up the pieces. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Mason. We now move to closing speeches. I call first Alex Cole-Hamilton. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you very much indeed, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, a fortnight ago, I engaged in a very fun activity with Martin Whitfield, MSP, Monica Lennon, MSP. It's St Andrews University Union, which was the show debate for their Freshers Week, and it was a great event. And the House, the motion before the House, which I was lead proposition for, was that this House has no faith in His Majesty's government. I thought just 10 weeks in, as we were, that that was a little miserly, but it was an interesting thought experiment to which I applied myself. The large part of my argument was around the idea that it is not really possible to have faith in a government elected to a landslide majority, one of the oldest parliaments in the world, on just 34% of the vote of those people who bothered to show up and cast their ballot during the elections. And 80% of the adult age population did not vote for Labour, but such is our arcane voting system. However, since that time, the faith I want to have in Labour has been eroded still further to a degree. I understand that it needs to move cautiously. I welcome some moves it's made, particularly the announcement this afternoon that GB Energy is to be sited in Aberdeen, and very much hope that will pump prime the just transition of that vital energy region of energy security. But Liberal Democrats have been surprised and dismayed, I think, by some of the other decisions and omissions that the Labour Party can be found guilty of. For example, the retention of the two-child cap, which has been well rehearsed this afternoon, the winter fuel payment, which I covered in my own remarks. I think I agree in large part with much of the substance of the government motion, and indeed the remarks of the Finance Secretary. The statements and assertions of both are absolutely true, but I think she fails to acknowledge the analysis of very august institutions like Scotland's own Fiscal Commission, that body, that government-led body which marks the financial homework of this government, which has stated that much of the fiscal pressures that we face, both in the in-year spending cuts that we've been asked to look at very recently, and indeed in the cuts that we anticipate to come, are caused in large part by the political decisions of this administration. We have yet to see the measure of those cuts, but I think Murdo Fraser is absolutely right that it is not the hallmark of a progressive government to lay down a freeze in council tax under the guise, as it may be, of protecting people from the cost of living, when actually we all agree, most of us agree, that the council tax is an iniquitous policy and a regressive tax. So actually, by freezing it, you are helping more well-off families than those who have nothing. Presiding Officer, there's no escaping the malignant inheritance that was handed down by the hapless Conservative government to this new Labour administration. I don't think we can blame them for that. Isn't it astonishing to see the cognitive dissonance of former Prime Minister Liz Truss, who just yesterday, some 2 years following the failure of her disastrous economic plan, issued an I told you so video. I mean, I don't know what universe she is living in, but Murdo, I think, made some additionally compelling and amusing remarks for a speech that was for some debate, but I'm not sure it was for this debate, because presiding officer, is a fascinating exercise to hear him offer his insight on tax policy when I'm old enough to remember when Murdo Fraser came to this chamber and was proselytising for the Truss-Quarteng mini-budget and demanding that the Scottish Government reflect its tax policy in their own. It is a position that perished alongside the lettuce that defeated Liz Truss in longevity. Daniel Johnson, I thought, picked that theme up. A panic in the city was created by the financial incompetence of the Conservative Party under Liz Truss, and subsequently, he pointed rightly to the collapse of the gilt markets, which actually I think is something we have not really seen in modern British economic history. It set the markets into panic and massively devalued our currency and brought interest rates skyrocketing, the cost of which is being felt by our constituents in the mortgage bills that they pay. He, in a typically measured contribution, I thought, called for patience for his government. Now, I understand that. He asked us to wait. But the straws in the wind are still troubling. And I come back to the fact that our MPs, Labour MPs and Liberal Democrat MPs, both walked through the no lobbies together in opposition to the two-child cap when it was first introduced. This is a policy that Liberal Democrats had spent 5 years preventing the Tory government from introducing. I am very sorry that the Labour Party don't still hold on to that principle that it is iniquitous and it is harming people at a material level. What was true for the iniquities of the rate clause then is equally true now. And winter fuel, I come back to the reference I made to the fact that I think we can all remember the days of the cold weather payments, which was brought in to stop the spectre of pensioners dying in our modern developed country, but for want of putting the heating on. I hope we do not go back to these points. It was interesting to hear Kevin Stewart, clearly a latent convert to the notion of capital flight. He referenced that several times in his speech. But we know that there have been several occasions when our party has supported his government on tax, but we stopped doing so in the last couple of years because of capital flight. Behavioural change is a thing. Finally, presiding officer, Liberal Democrats would make the whole the hole that has been created in our national finances, we would do by several things. Firstly, by reversing the tax on big banks, by hammering the social media giants who do so much of the harm in terms of the mental ill health of our young people, and by closing capital gains loopholes. All of these represent a cogent economic policy which does not have to harm the most vulnerable in our society. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I now call Patrick Harvey, similarly up to 6 minutes. Mr Harvey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Reflecting on the debate, quite a few members have spoken about the causes of the financial situation facing both governments. And I think there has been something a little bit missing from those reflections on causes, because while a huge amount of what the Conservative government over the last 15 years has done, whether that's the austerity that began with the coalition, whether it's the obsession with public sector debt, which public sector debt should be seen as a source of investment rather than something to be ashamed of, allowing huge amounts of private wealth to be hoarded by the super rich individuals and corporations, again a drag on investment by allowing that hoarding of wealth, whether it was the hardest of hard Brexits, whether it was the Liz Truss mini budget, all of these things, there has been substantial opposition to what the Conservative government was doing. They crashed on with their own agenda despite that solid opposition. And to hear some of the speeches today, I think one or two of the Conservative members might have contributed to the script for that bizarre self-pity video that we saw from Liz Truss yesterday. If only I'd been allowed to crash on with the mini budget after all. Contrast this, though, with the criticisms that have been made of the reasons for the Scottish Government's very, very difficult financial situation. Now, some of that has been imposed from outside. Some of it is the result of UK changes. Some of it, to be sure, is the result of Scottish Government decisions as well. But the difference is that most of those decisions were supported by the large majority of Parliament. There are aspects I didn't support, many years of the council tax freeze, which is, again, a damaging impact on public sector finances and benefited the wealthiest. But most of the Chamber supported that policy. Commitment of capital budgets on wildly expensive, unsustainable, high-cost, high-carbon infrastructure, which I've criticised, most of the Chamber has supported. Or indeed, the Scottish Child Payment and fair pay for public sector workers, policies which I strongly support and which most of the rest of the Chamber supported as well. So most of the decisions that have been made in Scotland that worsen the financial position of the Scottish Government have been made with political support across parties. I think that's worth reflecting on. Now, I understand why the Scottish Government in its motion... I'll give way.
Liz Lumsden.
Taken an intervention. So does he now regret supporting the council tax freeze that we've seen from the government quite recently?
Patrick Harvey.
I never did. In fact, it's not only these dangerous extremists, not only the dangerous extremists who are criticising that policy, but many others, including anti-poverty organisations, criticised that policy. It was bad policy and it was bad politics. Look, I understand why the government has brought the motion that it has, and there isn't anything in that motion that I disagree with. They want to draw attention to the impact of austerity to date, on the ongoing fiscal rules, the austerity fiscal rules, on the lack of a serious investment plan from the UK government, and Daniel Johnson mentioned some of the areas where they do intend to invest, but even before the election, they dropped the £28 billion investment pledge on net zero, which would just have brought the UK up to a comparable level of investment with our neighbouring countries. The government's criticising as well, I think, the process, the lack of cooperation with the UK government. Even the winter fuel payment decision came with bare moment's notice to the Scottish government about that decision coming, or indeed the lack of Scottish autonomy, the severe limits on Scotland's ability to make different choices. I understand why those points are being made. I think it's the truth, but I think it's an incomplete truth. And so the Green motion... The Green Amendment seeks to add to the government motion because there are some important parts that are missing. In particular, the lack of any recognition that wealth taxes, taxes on high incomes and taxes on corporate profits are an absolutely necessary part of either the Scottish or the UK path out of these incredible fiscal challenges. I'm afraid I do need to make progress. Also missing is the choices that we do have. Because I want, just as the Cabinet Secretary, just as the whole government wants to see policy change from the UK government and a change in the powers available to the Scottish government, I want both of those as well. But whatever context we face in terms of UK policy or Scotland's powers, this government and this parliament still have the responsibility to use the powers we do have to the maximum, and we're not yet doing so. The Scottish Greens have made the case not only for those policies like Scottish Child Payment and others, but we've also successfully brought to the Chamber the solutions that show how we can pay for them. It's because of the work of Greens over years that we have progressive taxation in this country and an extra £1.5 billion in the Scottish budget every year. It's because of the work of the Scottish Greens that we have already made progress on more local powers, whether that's council tax on second and empty homes, whether that's the transient visitor levy, the workplace parking levy, as options for councils, and with more to come, as my colleague mentioned, the carbon land tax and others. We need to go further on this. And finally, presiding officer, in closing, we need to cut unsustainable investment in those high-cost, high-carbon pieces of infrastructure and invest instead on what will cut costs and cut emissions, like energy-efficient homes and buildings that use renewables and not fossil fuels. Presiding officer, today we will support not only the Green Amendment but the government motion, but whatever happens with the vote today, the challenge will remain. Regardless of the policy context or the power context, the Scottish Government will have to go further with the powers it does have.
Thank you. I now call on Martin Whitfield, up to 6 minutes. Mr. Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer. And it has this afternoon been a fascinating debate, and I have to say, not churlishly, but I expected worse than we heard. And actually, there's been some very interesting and fascinating contributions from.
I was about to speak, Phil.
Some fascinating contributions, and I do, in fact, want to start with the Cabinet Secretary and her confirmation that there is better communication between the two governments. Because at the end of the day, politicians who are elected to any venue represent those people who send them here. And it is an obligation to have those discussions. Sometimes difficult discussions, but actually it's only through those discussions that solutions will come about. And also the welcoming of GB Energy, and in particular the input that the Scottish Government have towards the Memorandum of Understanding, which is important. And I'm sure the House, as many speakers have done, have welcomed the announcement as to where GB Energy will be based in Aberdeen, which is the right place, but also in future with sites in both Edinburgh and Glasgow, so that the challenge of drawing on the expertise that sits within this country can be found. And I'd also like to, with my slight tongue in my cheek, welcome Murdo Fraser's contribution. His newfound, wonderful new world of not being in government anywhere and the freedoms that it has allowed him to do. And I look forward to the future when we will see more and more of those contributions. But indeed, you know, this debate on Scotland's priorities, and I agree with Mark Griffith that, you know, there are very important things that have been discussed here today, sits in an environment where next week the Scottish Government will sit down with the UK Government, along with the Welsh Government, to discuss these matters. But it also sits in the environment of a general election from only a few months ago. And a number of speakers have talked about polling. But it was only 12 weeks ago that 37 Labour MPs were sent to Westminster to fight, not just for Scotland from the sidelines, but to fight from both inside the Cabinet and around that. And they will do that. Who are we going to go for? Kevin Stewart.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And it is a short period of time since those Labour MPs were elected. But from what I've heard, there's a lot of buyer's regret. Does Mr Whitfield not recognise that this continued austerity, the cuts to winter fuel payments, is having a real impact on folk, and people have lost trust already in the Labour government?
Martin Whitfield.
I think with regard to buyer's regret, I could point to a number of doors that I've knocked, indeed, over the past decade with regard to that, but certainly in the run-up to the election, people who changed their view. But as to buyer's regret about the government that they voted for, what they now have at the UK is a government that is being bitterly honest about the position that they found themselves in. And it is right that members across here have talked about the winter fuel allowance. But it is also right to say that the UK government identified £6 billion spent on the asylum system with nowhere for that money to come from. £3 billion on rail projects. A government under the Conservatives that had delayed the spending review until after the election and then updated the individual departments' budgets at fiscal events, putting even greater pressure on. And indeed, the Treasury reserves spent three times of. If you just give me one moment, because I have an apology to offer to the member before I will let her in. And the Treasury reserves that were spent three times in just 3 months. And that was 18 months after the economy was crashed with the underfunded promises made previously. It's also right that discretionary spending commitments were made by the previous government without putting them to any spending envelope. And the fact is that when the Labour UK government went in, not just the politicians, but also those that advised were completely and utterly unaware of this. And the risk to the UK economy was phenomenal. And I must apologise to Christine Graeme for missing her contribution, which I will review later. But as some recompense, I will give way.
Christine Graeme.
It's very gentlemanly. You're a bit of a gentleman, Mr Whitfield.
Do the chair.
Yeah, beg your pardon. You're a bit of a gentleman, the member. So I just want to ask the member, does he think that making the winter fuel payment determinant on the fact that you claim pension credit the right thing to do to Scotland's pensioners, yes or no?
I'm less of a gentleman, Martin Whitfield.
And I return the gentleman's comment to the Deputy Presiding Officer in the chair. And at this time, At this time, with the financial crisis that the government was faced, it was a way of identifying a saving. But remember the £150 warm home discount, the £500 million household support fund, which will deliver consequentials to the SNP government here to support low-income pensioners. Hard decisions have to be made, and indeed we have heard both the Cabinet Secretary and the Chancellor talk about the challenges that the budgets that they have to present coming forward are there. I am conscious of time, and I would like to have made comments about a number of the contributions which I think were particularly valuable. I do want to say I do find it disappointing that this very important debate has taken place in the absence of a committee. The committee journeys abroad were fixed many, many months ago. And actually, I think, to herald the contribution that John Mason, a newer member of that committee, has made, but not speaking on behalf of the committee, I think we've missed contributions from those voices this afternoon. I'm grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Whitfield. I now call on Brian Whittle, up to 7 minutes, please. Mr Whittle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I just say in the outset there, listening to Martin Whitfield saying that the government were being bitterly honest, I think potentially that the public might have welcomed that bitter honesty during the election.
Yes, exactly.
I would say I welcome the opportunity to speak in this debate, but I'm just warming up. I'm a wee bit older now. I need a wee bit more warm up. I would say I welcome the opportunity to speak in this debate, but let's be honest. We've spent 2 hours on a topic that could basically have been a letter from the Cabinet Secretary to the Chancellor. All this after a mere 30 minutes devoted to winter preparedness in Scotland's NHS. But what else should we expect from a Scottish Government that have always prioritised grandstanding over efficacy? Even a brief glance at their motion today demonstrates a total lack of self-awareness or economic credibility. Attacking others for underinvestment resulting in stagnation and decline, while Scotland's economic growth under the SNP stewardship has failed to keep pace with the rest of the UK. An economic performance gap to the tune of £624 million. To give some context, it's about 10 times what the Scottish Government would have needed to avoid real-term cuts to local authority core funding, and will give way to the Cabinet Secretary.
Cabinet Secretary.
Economic credibility and fiscal credibility. Where is the economic or fiscal credibility? On the one hand, we've heard this afternoon calls for tax cuts, and on the other hand, calls for expenditure over a number of areas of government expenditure. That is economic illiteracy. Will Brian Whittle not accept that doesn't add up?
Brian Whittle.
I'm actually very grateful for the Cabinet Secretary for that intervention, because it actually highlights why the Scottish Government continue to fail. Because what she needs to understand, what the Cabinet Secretary should need to understand, is that when you invest in certain portfolios, it means you don't have to make that expenditure in other portfolios. And she well knows, because she has been Health Secretary, if you invest in things like education, that is an investment in health, and it's an investment in all the other portfolios. And this way in which the Scottish Government view investment in portfolios is why they continually fail. Now, however, I should commend Scottish Labour for their contributions today, because they have clearly learned well their lessons at the SNP school of blame shifting, where rule number one is if it doesn't matter if you're the one in power, it's still somebody else's fault. That is why slashing the winter fuel payment, a benefit introduced by Gordon Brown and left untouched by six Conservative chancellors, even as they fought to clean up the mess of the 2008 financial crash, meet the huge cost of furlough and the pandemic, and to support households through the cost of living crisis, was axed by a Labour chancellor within weeks of taking office. I'm not surprised this decision has shocked the SNP, of course. After all, they've been saying that anyone earning over £28,000 is a high earner. And here's a Labour Chancellor saying that people earning as little as £11,300 are well enough off to manage. This UK Labour Government came in promising change, Presiding Officer, and change they have delivered. I will give way to Daniel Johnson.
Daniel Johnson.
I'm grateful to give way, but given the Office of Budget Responsibility is on the record as saying it was not known and was not established, the budget that call, would he acknowledge that the facts were not known, and that's the responsibility of his government?
Brian Whittle.
Well, as Murdo Fraser said, £9 billion of that was down to the increases you gave in public sector pay. Unfunded. You have to. All these promises that Labour government
made
prior to coming into office were unfunded. Pensioners... I'll need to make some progress. Pensioners losing benefits to help cover the gap between the cost of bumper pay, sector pay deals Labour have agreed to, and what they could actually afford. And my colleague Douglas Lumsden eloquently highlighted an oil and gas sector reeling from extensions to profit levy, presumably to fund Ed Miliband's social media team, since Sue Gray's salary is swallowing up the SPAD budget. And pledges not to increase tax disappearing faster than the receipts for Keir Starmer's wardrobe. Britpop was riding high in the charts when Labour were last came to power, presiding officer. Unfortunately, it looks like this government misheard the lyrics. Blur sang "Park Life," not "Perk Life." But I don't want to spend too much time on Labour. Thank you. I don't want to spend. Yes, I particularly like that one. I don't want to spend too much time on Labour government, presiding officer. They're just in the door and still learning that being the government is much harder than blaming the government. The SNP, on the other hand, have no excuses. 17 years in government, and we have half the growth in the last decade than the rest of the United Kingdom. We have record NHS waiting lists. We have an education system in disarray. We have a justice system straining at the seams, and years of promised transport investment that have never materialised. The Scottish Government titled this debate UK, Scotland's UK budget, Scotland's priorities. I suggest, presiding officer, that time in this chamber will be better spent on the latter rather than the former. Now, I appreciate that Stephen Flynn clearly believes he could do the First Minister's job, but does the current First Minister really need to dedicate this time trying to prove he could do Stephen Flynn's? Scotland has its priorities, but increasingly they are not the SNP's, if they ever were. At a business day at the SNP conference, the glossy programme talked about Scotland being open for business and listing all the different sectors in their economy, apart from energy, which generates over £65 billion in turnover, and financial services, which are two most valuable industries, employing around 250,000 people. A minor failure in the grand tapestry of the SNP's abysmal approach to economic growth, presiding officer, but symptomatic of a lack of focus. Kate Forbes says makes many of the right noises about a new approach to the economy, but this government has a long track record of saying all the right things, then launching 16 separate consultations on a feasibility plan on how to do the right things. No more is it more obvious than our infrastructure, a subject highlighted by both my colleagues Murdo Fraser and Douglas Lumsden. Across Scotland, our rail and rail networks are in desperate need of investment, not only for economic benefit, but for safety and to get goods in and out, something the Greens don't seem to understand, from the A9 and the A96 in the North East to the A77 and the A75 in the South West. Years of promises and consultations, but little tangible improvement. I'm very aware of the time, presiding officer. They're talking about the UK government investment to deliver net
zero,
when
Mr.
they've wasted
Whittle.
Years failing to put the skills training in place while crowing about their now abandoned targets of a million homes with heat pumps. Some of the Scottish Government's cuts have been dramatic,
but
apparently the self-awareness budget has been limited altogether. Presiding officer.
I call on Ivan McKee to wind up to 9 minutes, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I'd like to start in a most unlikely place. I'm going to follow on from where Mark Griffin left off. To govern is indeed to choose. And the UK, new UK Labour government is indeed learning that the hard way, perhaps the shortest honeymoon on record. And I'm going to come back and talk more on that later. But first, I want to talk about the choices this SNP Scottish Government has made in office, constrained by our need every year, as the Deputy First Minister highlighted earlier, to balance our budget and those limited borrowing powers that we all understand and recognise. Because we recognise the value of public sector workers. Yeah. Public sector workers in Scotland get paid more, significantly more, and there are significantly more of them. 25% more police officers per head of population, 30% more nurses and midwives, 30% more GPs and 32% more teachers. Police officers getting paid £1,500 more, nurses £1,800 more, and teachers £2,000 more. We recognise the value of those public sector workers. Those are our priorities in government. Give way to Brian Whittle.
Brian Whittle.
Very grateful to the member for giving way. If there's so much more investment in health and in education, why are we still the unhealthiest nation in Europe? How is our education standards? Well, we are I hear the First Minister, we are the unhealthiest nation in Europe and we are sliding down education standards.
Let us hear Mr. Whittle.
I think you'll recognise, you looked at the stats, that Scotland's got the best performing A&E record in the whole of the UK. Key priority of this government, articulated by the First Minister, tackling child poverty. We're spending £1 billion more in social security Liberty than the Barnett consequentials that come from UK government. £137 million of that to mitigate UK government welfare policies. Welfare policies being continued, sadly and tragically, by the new UK Labour government. 320,000 under-16s in receipt of the Scottish Child Payment, helping 100,000 children in Scotland state of poverty. Choices made by this government raise £1 billion extra in tax as a result of the choices we made in government to support that social contract between government and people. Free tuition in Scotland, free prescriptions in Scotland, free travel for and buses for under-22s in Scotland. And as a consequence of that, more taxpayers actually moving from the south to the north and a growth in top-rate taxpayers in Scotland. Yeah. We agree with Labour on the need to grow the economy. And since 2007, when this government came to power, GDP per head up 10.7% in Scotland versus less than the 6% that Daniel Johnson rightly identified for UK growth per head. Productivity also doubled under this SNP government compared to the growth rate across the rest of the UK. Earnings growth, wages growth in the last stats higher in Scotland than in the rest of the UK. Small business confidence higher in the FSB Small Business Index in Scotland than in the rest of the UK. Lower unemployment claiming count in Scotland than the rest of the UK, and the best performing foreign direct investment anywhere in the UK outside of London. So turning to talk about this new Labour government and the tragic situation, the failure so far. Why, asked Daniel Johnson, are we having this debate now? This is exactly the time to have that debate to influence the new UK government and the new Chancellor, to make clear Scotland's priorities for what she should include in her first budget. So why does Scottish Labour not want to talk about it? Indeed, why have only three of them turned up today to not talk about Scotland's asks on the UK government? Well, I'll tell you something it does want to talk about. I'll tell you something it does want to talk about the UK government and get their asks on the record. The one Cammy Day, Labour leader of Edinburgh City Council, the same city that Daniel Johnson represents, he's written to the UK government to ask for them to end the two-child cap. He has written to the UK government to ask them to end the cuts in the pension and winter fuel allowance. And while he's at it, talking about economic growth, he's written to the UK government for them to reverse the cancelled planned £800 million investment in Edinburgh University and their exascale supercomputer. So Cammy Day gets it, but Daniel Johnson doesn't. So what else is going on? Energy prices going up, not down, as promised in the election campaign by Labour, and in an energy-rich Scotland, fuel poverty being continued by Labour. Listen to Anas Austerity, give me 1 minute, listen to Anas Austerity Sarwar on GMS this morning, spinning and struggling to give timescales when GB Energy is going to deliver the £300 reduction promised in energy prices for the people of Scotland. Maybe this Parliament, maybe not, maybe the next Parliament, who knows. Meanwhile, Ian, missing war chest Murray, desperately seeking his £150 million war chest. Where
Minister,
is that?
If I may just remind you, we do not use nicknames in the chamber.
Sorry. Intervention.
Douglas Lumsden.
I thank the Minister for taking the intervention. Would he not agree with me that we'd be in a better position if the SNP government scrapped a presumption against oil and gas?
Minister.
This government both supports our energy sector, one of the most important sectors in Scotland, and we support driving forward investment to ensure the transition to net zero happens and a just transition. So let's talk about winter fuel payments. Again, not many Labour members here will tell you privately in the corridors that they're deeply embarrassed and upset by what's happened on winter fuel payment. Christine Graham articulating the impact of that very well. Labour putting party before pensioners. John Mason, meanwhile, his intervention made the very astute comment that some pay lots of money for Taylor Swift tickets, but then again, some don't. The new Prime Minister certainly doesn't have his troubles to seek. I would suggest less designer suits and more empty suits is what we're seeing from Keir Starmer. No honeymoon, no wonder. So turning to our asks of this new UK Labour government, fully fund, as the Cabinet Secretary has outlined, fully fund public sector pay increases so that Scotland gets the money due from it as a consequence of those pay rises. Better still, why doesn't the UK government commit to raise public sector pay in England to the same level as in Scotland? That would be interesting. How about reverse cuts to capital, £1.3 billion of cuts to capital and nearly £300 million of cuts to financial transactions? If the UK government is serious about investing to grow the economy, that would be a good place to start to grow the economy and deliver net zero. Allow the Scottish government borrow £1 billion power so that we can take the steps needed to invest in the economy, reinstate that winter fuel payment, remove the two-child cap. Frankly, I'm not ambitious enough to ask them to copy the groundbreaking Scottish Child Payment, but maybe they want to get that on their radar as well and do the same down south that we've delivered for the people of Scotland in tackling child poverty. And, of course, change course on austerity. Our motion rightly mentions the letter from leading economists that identify the problem with the austerity measures that the UK Government is taking, focusing on austerity, not on investment to grow the economy. That direction needs to change. And while we're at it, the UK Government might want to consider reversing Brexit. The £40 billion lost every year to public sector revenues, more than double the black hole that they talk about endlessly. Just hear that again. The £40 billion lost as a consequence of the misguided, disastrous decision to leave the European Union, supported by this Labour government, double the black hole that they're trying to fill, and pensioners in Scotland paying the price of that misguided approach. I want to turn briefly to the amendments from the Greens and from the Lib Dems, and certainly they're much more considered than the Conservative or Labour offering, and there's a great deal of elements in both that I and the Government would strongly support, not least the ongoing work to explore levy powers for local government, support for social care investment and taxing social media companies properly, as has been identified in the Green amendments, but unfortunately we were unable to support them because of other factors in them, and they're deleting much of the certainly in the Lib Dems case, deleting the substance of our motion, which is, I don't understand why they've done that. So moving on to close, this Government has been determined to work constructively with the UK Government. The First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for Finance have met the Chancellor and made clear this Government wants to work together with the UK Government for the benefit of Scotland. The Cabinet Secretary will be meeting the Chief Secretary of the Treasury next month and putting forward Scotland's priorities for the budget. The Prime Minister said he wants to reset relations with the devolved governments, and we are taking him at his word, but this budget will be a test of that reset. The Cabinet Secretary said in her opening speech the Chancellor faces a choice in this budget, and I would like to remind members in this chamber of that choice. The Chancellor can choose to follow the tired playbook of previous UK governments, cuts to spending, low investment and no long-term ambition, or the Chancellor can chart a new course, one that promotes investment, looks to the long term and works with, not against, devolved governments. A budget that protects and values public services, invests in the infrastructure we need to grow our economy and make the transition to net zero, abolishes the previous government's damaging social security policies and takes real action to tackle child poverty. I urge members to support the government's motion today. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on the UK budget, Scotland's priorities. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of Business Motion 14639 in the name of Jamie Hepburn on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on a change to the business programme. Any member who wishes to speak to the motion should press their request to speak button, and I call on Jamie Hepburn to move the motion.
Move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak to the motion. Therefore, the question is that Motion 14639 be agreed. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed, and there are five questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is that Amendment 14614.2, in the name of Murdo Fraser, which seeks to amend Motion 14614, in the name of Shona Robison, on the UK budget, Scotland's priorities, be agreed. Are we all agreed? The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we'll move to a vote, and there'll be a short suspension to allow members to access digital voting.